Thank you. Thank you. On each conference these days, there should be a speaker talking about blockchain. So today, that's me. And taking the hype, amount of hype happening in the sphere, I'd like to focus today more on critics regarding the blockchain, and through critics trying to analyze how it can be useful for the field of artificial intelligence, which kinds and properties of the blockchain technologies are important from this perspective. So, machine intelligence. We all know that machine intelligence is not a singular object. It's not some sort of big brain in the cloud, a single one. It's multiple agents, so it's multiple agent system. For instance, you can think about a lot of autonomous driving cars, self-driving cars, about Internet of Things, mobile phones, all of them practically, all new models these days have special AI coprocessors and so on. So in a 5 years term, I think all the things will have some kind of specialized AI embedded. And all of them will start interact. They're already starting. And new interfaces like vehicle to vehicle, vehicle to environment, everything to everything, and protocols helping this interaction will evolve. I already know that a committee of United Nations is working on standardization of such protocols for autonomous vehicles. So this will continue. And it will lead us to the situation where we will face a multiple Byzantine faults and security issues. What are these Byzantine faults? We can imagine a road with a lot of cars, and most of that cars will be self-driving in some perspective. And these cars will interchange information in a way that will allow them to take decisions about the speed and direction of movement. And there could be a situation where there is a sort of Byzantine car. Byzantine car is the car that is not following the common rules and trying to cheat or trying to attack somebody. Like, for instance, it could be a terrorist or whatever. And how we will distinguish the information which is correct from the disinformation that can appear in a system like this. That's how we come to the field of Byzantine fault tolerance. It's part of the computer science that have started from the research performed by the guys who have created PGP algorithms. And since the early days from the 1982, maybe for 15 years, there were no solution to the problem like this. And after that, a number of proposals have appeared. These proposals was naming the solution as Byzantine fault tolerance solutions. And distributed databases actually have birth from the rise of these technologies because distributed databases have to come to the same results and to the same state in the decentralized system where there could be a network failures, there could be a computer failures, and so on. So, however, that wasn't a perfect solution. And only with the appearance of Bitcoin, there happened something new since the 1982. What Bitcoin did? It added a game theory to the equation. So now, for now, it's not a Byzantine fault tolerance only. It's also a game theory that allows to create economical incentivization, economical stimuli that can lead to the solution that can be provable, workable in a provable way. So, the Bitcoin gave rise to the blockchain technologies. What is blockchain? Blockchain basically have four main qualities. First of all, it is a trusted, persistent data records. Trusted, persistent. But these trusted, persistent data records appear inside a trustless environment. So we do not trust the participants, but we still can trust the data that are coming from these participants. Why? Because of Byzantine fault tolerance and game theory. So it is secured by economical incentives, and it doesn't have any kind of central governance. Once again, without central governance, there would be no trust, but still there could be trusted communications and trusted data and trusted decisions taken in a such trustless environment. From a technical perspective, blockchain is a replicative state machine. It's a kind of distributed database that utilizes asymmetric cryptography to add accountability. So we can say who did what. We can say that maybe in quasi-anonymous way, we will know only a public key, but we can still attribute an action to some kind of public key. And it is an ordered immutable set of historical state changes. So we can audit that from a history perspective and find what did happen at some different stages. Blockchain key parameters are security. Sometimes it is called also immutability or persistence. It's not a quite synonymous, but very close things to each other. And it means that the past history of this transaction does not change. So the change is not allowed and can be tracked and reversed. And if somebody made something like performed a payment transaction, it can't be changed, reversed, or whatever. This leads to audibility and accountability. Liveness is ability to post a new transaction, a new state update, and it means that the system should be a censorship resistant. So if you have censorship, there is no guarantee that your transaction will appear in the history eventually. That's why the liveness from the other side means absence of censorship. Blockchain-based distributed systems achieve these qualities by following the same consensus protocol. And this following is stimulated and supported by economic incentives. What is consensus? Consensus is required for blockchain operation in a public environment. I will talk a bit later about private and federated blockchains, which are a sort of gameplay, meaning nothing additionally to the decentralized databases. Consensus adds rules by which distributed parts can come to the same conclusion and can come to the same state. And it achieves that by adding some economical stimuli like mining rewards and specially designed game theory settings. Part of that design is appearance of cryptocurrency, a value inside the network that should be transferred together with the transactions and state changes. And together, this is a solution to Byzantine generals' problem. There is no other way that is known to humanity these days that can solve it. So, appearance of trust in a trustless environment comes from the value that is circulating inside that environment. So that's why I'm saying that not public blockchain, blockchain without a cryptocurrency, and blockchain without Bitcoin is useless because it's just a decentralized database that is existing for about 20 years. So, additionally to technology, well, blockchain merges two worlds, technology and economics. From a technological perspective, it is a decentralized database. It is a distributed computations, state changes, which can be Turing complete or Turing incomplete. It is a peer-to-peer mesh network, and it is cryptographically secured. From an economical perspective, it is a multi-agent economy. Each agent in this system becomes an economical agent. It is based on game theory, and by this, it creates a free and open market with the trade relations. It's just very interesting outcome that comes from the technology and adding the game theory to the equation. It is non-state system. It is decentralized, and it is not linked to any particular owner, business, resource, or whatever. Technologically, blockchain means a sequence of blocks. What is a block? A block is some set of state changes ordered historically. So you can see in these data structures, I used Haskell, which is less verbose and shows the more structure than syntax. So block is composed of some header, description about block size and transaction count, and actual transactions. transactions are ordered. And block header contains a version, a reference to a previous block header that adds a sequence to the blockchain, a Merkle root, which is cryptographically organized data structure allowing to both order the transactions and check their correctness, and a timestamp. That's basically all. Quite simple, isn't it? But additionally to a blockchain, usually blockchain, public blockchains use some sort of smart contracts. They was proposed even before the blockchain appeared. It's contracts that executed automatically depending on some conditions without any additional decisions to be taken. It is used since Bitcoin in most of blockchains to automate state transition changes according to some rules, like with a time or with a multiple signatures. They can be Turing complete and Turing incomplete. Turing incomplete contracts comes with Bitcoins, and they have very limited functionality, like multiple signatures to perform a payment, a Lightning network, and organization of side chains, which is a proposed technology for Bitcoin scaling. They're quite secure because of Turing incompleteness. You can formally verify which results can get from which results you can get from that or that contract, and be sure that they work correctly. This is a typical example of smart contract in a sort of Bitcoin assembly. It's called Bitcoin script. After that, there was a number of propositions of creating Turing-complete blockchains, blockchains with a Turing-complete smart contracts. The most famous one is Ethereum and different Ethereum clones, and also Rootstock, which adds Ethereum virtual machine to Bitcoin. They are quite highly vulnerable. Probably you heard about all those hacks happening in Ethereum network, and why they are vulnerable is because they have a Turing completeness. It means you can develop any sort of software, and it's quite hard to formally analyze the way the problem can work. It is also single-threaded, meaning that you have a sort of global computer with a single thread, because each node computes every operation and repeats all operations in the blockchain. And if you write some smart contracts, it will be performed everywhere in the same way, but there is only a single thread. You can think about that like a single computer with thousands of keyboards given to developers. So it's quite a big scalability issue. Here is an example of a smart contract written with a Solidity language. Unfortunately, for historical reasons, the first language for Turing-complete smart contracts, the first large, widely adopted language, is a JavaScript type. So the motto of Ethereum is the code as a law. I think it wasn't a nice design solution to select as a law a JavaScript type language. Something more functional will be probably more appropriate. Unfortunately, we have this legacy, and that's why it's very hard to formally analyze and develop stable smart contracts with Solidity. So, coming to your problems for now. Why blockchain? Did it conquer the world if it promised so many? And it's already 10 years since blockchain was created, and there is no large-scale world-ready production systems on it except probably Bitcoin. Well, there is a number of problems. The first of them are linked, once again, to smart contracts. I already talked about that. It's a single-threaded, all these vulnerabilities, scalability issues, and so on. The second part of the problems are related to a consensus. The consensus that allows us to come to the same state change in a decentralized environment. The problem basic is, if you need to update a state, how you decide who have a right to do the state update? There is only two ways. You can do that by some randomness, but with the randomness, you have to have each node having the same random number generator. Well, it's contradictory. Or you can get that by agreement between the nodes. So that's basically two options. What did Bitcoin is that it proposed a way to create a randomness and entropy in decentralized environment without making each node producing the same random number. It's called proof of work. You just compute some specific hashes, and one operation that take a lot of energy, you produce an entropy, and with some probability you get a small number which you show to network, and you can prove that you have found it. And it proves, it gives you a right to sign a block and update a stage of blockchain. That's simple, all about proof of work. I have to say that it's unfortunately the only one decentralized working way to achieve a consensus these days. The other propositions are not yet adopted, not yet tested in the large-scale production environments. They are quite promising, they can be working well, but it still have to be proved. So with the randomness, there is a proof to get on-chain randomness. It's early proof-of-stake algorithms trying to do that. And unfortunately, it is predictable. If you take randomness from some open source data, you can predict that. You can organize cartels to explore and to achieve more rewards, get some additional benefits from it. And unfortunately, these all systems wasn't properly working. Off-chain sources of randomness, they have another problem. There would be a sort of central oracle that provides these random numbers to a network. And instead of decentralized system, we got some centralized solution. So, okay, let's try to make an agreement. But with agreement between nodes, we have this history of Byzantine fault-tolerant algorithms, which exists for 30 years for now. And again, they're vulnerable because they have very low Byzantine fault tolerance. It's about only 1/3 of network. They're slow, and unfortunately, there was no yet implementations of these algorithms in a working blockchain, public blockchains yet. There is a delegation or voting mechanism where the nodes can vote for delegates, and then only delegates achieve an agreement. So if you have not 1,000 participants, but only 2 of them, or 10 of them, they can easily agree on the order who can sign a block. This is called a delegated proof of stakes, and you heard about probably Steemit, BitShares, and EOS. They are all utilizing this solution. And the last one is, but again, it's a sort of centralized way. You have only 10 agents. It's not purely decentralized system. And if you take a self-driving cars and they are voting for somebody who takes decisions for them, it's just not working in these cases. So most have problems with the finality. Most of the consensuses have problems with the finality. You can't be sure that the history wouldn't change. There is always a near zero probability, that, but it is positive and sometimes even unmeasurable. So again, there is no proper working consensus. Well, people searching for solutions, and there is a number of propositions which, for my opinion, are non-solutions for these problems, but they are quite popular. First of all, we have to remember that blockchain is not a self-aim. It's just not like a gold pill that you can take and you will cure cancer or whatever. And it's just a technology that solves at these days, at this stage, some particular problems, but there could be a better technology that can do that. But still, if you remove a cryptocurrency from blockchain, you have no economical incentives, and it wouldn't be protected, and it would from non-following consensus by some nodes. So there would be no Byzantine tolerance. If you made that private or federative, you already have partially Byzantine fault tolerance decentralized databases. You can just add a record with the cryptographical signatures, and you don't need to take all this burden of building a blockchain type solution. Just take what is working already. And such blockchains is just a buzzword to, you know, attract capital, make a marketing, PR, and all that stuff. So that's my critical point of view on the most of the blockchains happening today. So here I'm presenting a project that we are trying to build. We are trying to build a censorship-resistant public consensus, which will be more efficient and which will allow the level of scalability required for decentralized AI computations and machine learning. We call it Pandora Boxchain. It's a Pandora Box put it into a blockchain. Why Pandora? Because we think that a lot of people are scary about AI, so it's a sort of Pandora box which can be opened by AI. And it utilizes a consensus engine which we call a Prometheus. You probably heard about Prometheus. He brought an intelligence to humanity, so probably this will help to bring an intelligence to machines. Prometheus is a hybrid consensus which extends a smart contracts to generic computing suitable for AI models. It is run in parallel and trustless decentralized network. Computing results are provided by proof-of-work consensus, but it's a special type of proof-of-work. It's useful work. It's actually the real AI models running in the network, and these computations is the work that can be proven and allows to achieve a consensus and get randomness. And the value transfer is separated from this computing level into a proof-of-stake type consensus, but it operates once again on top of the proof-of-work and layer, and this allows additional security. And randomness is created by computing actual models. So here are the layers, proof of computing work and proof of reputation. And reputation is coming from performing computer work and proving that the results of this computing work are correct. And this gives the right to update a state for the transactions and for the value transfers which happens on the other level. There is a number of sublayers that allow scalability, so it's a multi-layer blockchain with the side chains, with the state channels. And we have working for some time on the formal description of the protocol, so it will be hopefully published soon. And one of these layers is this proof of cognitive work. We call it Poseidon protocol. You can check the current state of this implementation on the GitHub. How it works? For instance, you have an AI model and you have some data set that you would like to compute. And what you do is you create a job for the computation, and the nodes of network are assigned this job in a random way, sort of lottery. Once they get assignment, they perform a computation. The whole data set is split into batches, and each node computes a single batch, and it is computed only by a single node. Not all the network repeats the computation, just a single node. It provides the results, and these results are get verified by three nodes with a higher reputation. They're picking a random parts of this batch, about 10%, and only three nodes repeats 10% of the computing. If they don't find any faults, we can assure, with the game theory, we can prove that with a high probability, the whole computations are done correct. And both workers and verifiers have a stake, and if they are lying, they are losing that stake. And this is the game setting that allows us to prove that they will be non-Byzantine. So if there is some failures and the results are not proven to be correct, there is an arbitration procedure which can achieve a finality of saying that this computing is done correct or incorrect without repeating it. That's the most important part. And this allows a scalability of AI and machine intelligence working in a decentralized network. There is another layer, which we call a Hyperion. It's a replicative state machine for settlements. It's separated from the AI computing, and it is non-Turing complete. So we have a security, and this Turing completeness operating on a single node doesn't affect the security of the settlement layers. And it have a provable finality and security. It have a censorship resistance and a scalability. So we hope that this protocol will allow situations where we can have a multiple intelligent agents interacting and protecting these systems from terrorists or any possible Byzantine or network's faults. And it's a sort of protection from a Skynet appearing because no single agent will be able to fool the rest of the network with a protocol like that. Other key properties includes that this protocol creates basically an open market for big data, for AI models, and for computing power. And that will boost the speed of AI evolvement because you can always sell your results on this market. And if you have developed some open source model, you can still earn money from that because network is paying you for executing your model each time. And you can, you know, steal or hack it because this is the rules of the consensus in decentralized network. And there is a Byzantine fault tolerance which wouldn't allow hacking happening. And so on. I wouldn't spend the last time for describing more properties of the system. We will work on the more privacy and zero knowledge. Maybe you heard about that. That's a cute cryptography allowing you to not to expose your sensitive data, so your data sets would be protected from the stealing, and so on. So our solution that we propose takes such issues as AI regulations, and we would like to show that economical incentives, stimuli, works better than any kind of regulation. Regulations on big data and protecting private data would be replaced with zero knowledge. And the idea of creating some sort of kill switch for AI that can stop AI from damaging humanity, very risky idea, because with the game theory, you can easily understand that if there is somebody who can kill you, your first goal would be to kill this person. So putting a kill switch on top of AI is actually creating more risks. So better to create an open, free market with the agents being able to trade, multiple agents, and it creates more protection than trying to regulate what is happening. And instead of Asimov laws, we will have audibility and accountability, which comes from blockchain. So that's basically all. You can grab a QR code, read more. You can check GitHub, our website, write us an email. Okay, you can take a photo because there is one more thing I'd like to talk today. And a bit of futurism. What we can say about general progress with AI today? I think that it is engineering progress. Quite a lot of engineering advancements happening, like CNN, deep learning, and so on, but not a lot of science. There is no progress in the way we understand a cognitive process, for instance. And there are new directions that can help to evolve AI even further. Among them are engineering directions like multi-agent systems, distributed decentralized systems, and new biologically inspired cognitive architectures. And the scientific directions, game theory, Byzantine fault tolerance, and complexity science. Why is it important? Because if you'd like AI to evolve further, you need not a singular AI, but interacting AIs, multiple AIs, like humanity have developed in a community, in a civilization, only due to language and interaction. So the further progress should require something more than just done today. And I believe that this is something is a blockchain. If we think about evolution, it happens when selection acts on a divergent population. Modern AIs, they are singular. Information transfer allows to species exchange information through viruses. Cells emit chemical and electrical signals. Animals communicate with mimics and emotions. Humans with language. What about AI? It does not talk to each other. And if we would like to build some sort of language for AI, what we will require? We will require consensus, persistence, and liveness. Consensus is that each agent gets the same sense of signal as another's. DNA is interpreted by any cell in the same way. Any person speaking language can write the same text in the same way. Persistence, it can't diminish with the time. So if you have written something, it can keep for ages. DNA keeps for millions of years. So blockchain is perfect for consensus and persistence, and it can be a tool that will give a language to future developed AI. Thank you. We probably don't have a time for questions.
Okay. Blockchain hype is similar to peer-to-peer hype 20 plus years ago. Do you think we might turn back to centralized solutions in the future, like we did with
peer-to-peer? Well, we can even kill ourselves as a humanity, so we can do a lot of stupid things. But shall we do that? I think not, because decentralized systems are anti-fragile, while centralized are fragile. If you would like to create more fragility, we can turn back, for sure.
Thanks. In public road and self-driving car use case, we have basically trusted third party government. Should we have permission or permissionless network for these scenarios?
I'm for public permissionless networks, because otherwise economical stimuli are not working and you again need some central power and the authority, which creates more fragility.
Thanks. And the third one, when is the ICO?
Oh, there is no ICO. We are attracting not funds, we are attracting brains. So there is initial brain offering. If anybody of you wants to offer your brains to us, we are open for that. Thank you.
Thank you.